We're going to talk about icebergs for a minute. There are things underneath the iceberg that we don't see that are kind of interesting and sometimes scary. We see these icebergs here in Alaska. I think this is probably was taken from a place down in South America, but icebergs are very unique. But do you know that when you look at an iceberg, you're only seeing 12% of the iceberg? Most of it is down below, and we don't know what's down there. And the reason I wanted to talk about icebergs is because I think, as people, we meet each other, we get to know each other, but a lot of times we're only seeing 12% of each other, because there's a lot more inside of us than what you're seeing, like icebergs. So that's more like what they look like. I've seen this for years in my chiropractor's office, and as he's working on me, he's telling me, oh, there's so much to work on, but you're not knowing, you know, and I'd look at that. So anyway, that's an image I want you to have, that what you see is beautiful, but what is underneath sometimes can be very troubling. And it can be very troubling in our lives, what we're not seeing with each other. And what we know is inside of us that other people are not seeing when they get to know us. There are things in our lives that become stumbling blocks, that what's underneath there becomes stumbling blocks in our life. And it's things like disappointment, hurt, anger. Those are things that are just down in there. And we all have them. And we have many times very decent reasons to feel those kind of things. But if we don't come to terms with some of them in a healthy way that we learn something from them, they can also just continue to be a stumbling block in our life. I want to tell you about this week. We were with John, by the way, and he spoke very wonderfully about George Durant. And George Durant is someone we travel with. And whenever I see George, he always says, you say, how are you doing, George? He said, it's my best day so far. That's just George. You know, now, was he lucky and he just got all good days? Or does he choose to say, I'm going to make today my best day so far? And that is what he's known for. Well, a few months ago, well, first of all, I have to backtrack for a second. 20 years ago, I had an idea. I thought I would start a business that took people, LDS people, on cruises. But I also had another idea. I know I'm on these ships. I'll buy all this art, and I'll have this art company in Washington, which is where I lived, and I'll sell beautiful art. And it was called Art from Abroad. That usually gets a little bit of a laugh because it's kind of can be taken whatever way you want. Anyway, I was starting them both up at the same time, which was really a stupid idea. I don't know what I was thinking, but it became very clear that when I got close to starting both of them officially up, that I couldn't do two things like that at the same time. So it's kind of like whichever one took off is the one that got me. Well, I had an art auction up in Olympia, Washington, this huge affair at this big hotel. I think three people showed up. It was painfully embarrassing. I had all this art. I had two women friends who were there with me showing the art as I would explain about the different types of art and the artist. And I would go on and ask if there were bids, and there were none. And of course, then we moved to another one, and I did this whole thing with a big smile on my face, just dying inside. And in the end, obviously I said, that is not going to work. Sell the art, close it up, put the cruise lady company into that building, and we move on. Well, that was a painful memory. And what did I learn from it? I learned that, you know, we all have ideas. Sometimes you try things, sometimes it doesn't work. However, I could just think, well, I'm a loser and I can't do anything and just go off and live my life like that. Or I could say, well, I'm going to do the other thing. And over the years, I have been so thankful that it bombed. because if I it didn't, well, first of all, we wouldn't be here together. But second of all, my life has taken a very uplifting, exciting, wonderful direction. Or I could be selling art in Olympia, Washington. So when I think back of that failure, I think, oh, I'm so glad that went the way it went. Or that's what I would be doing. And so sometimes you have to have maybe stand back a little, have perspective, a different perspective on what happens than maybe a lot of time. It's been a lot of years. But I think that many times in our life, things that happen, we have a judgment about how it is. And later on, we have to say, well, you know, looking back, if that hadn't happened, I wouldn't be here, or I wouldn't know this person, or I wouldn't be doing that. So I guess what I'm saying is, yes, I failed, and that was embarrassing, and that's still in there, deep down underneath the iceberg. But that is one that I say, I am so glad for what I learned and how it turned out because of how my life took a whole different direction. Now, back to George Durant. George Durant, my best day so far. Well, a year ago, I had one of my best days so far in my life. I went to BYU Education Week in Provo, Utah, which if you have never done that, you're missing out. It's an amazing experience. So I was running around, seeing all these great speakers, visiting with them, learning from them, running into people I knew. It was great. I ran into somebody earlier in the week that had traveled with me, Randall Wright. He's in Texas. He's been speaking at Ed Week for about 25 years. And we had traveled together many years ago, and I went to his class, and he's just fascinating. And it was the last day of Ed Week, and I went into the, I can't remember, the cafeteria there. And so I went in, and I saw him, and I thought, oh, I'll just go over and visit with Randall. Randall brought up an incident that I had had about 9 years, 8 years or 9 years ago. Well, okay, 9 years, 7 hours. 6 minutes and 3 seconds ago, which tells you it's an experience that's very painful to me, and I'm going to share it with you. He said, whatever happened to that guy that traveled with you all those years ago, and you gave him an evaluation sheet, and he said some really mean things, and it really hurt your feelings. Whatever happened on that? First of all, I said, thank you, Randall, for bringing that up, because, you know, I've been trying to forget it for a lot of years. I said, you know, Randall, I found a way to deal with that memory. I don't give evaluation sheets out anymore. You know? Hey, and that is the appropriate response. You laugh. Except Randall didn't. I said it, and he just looked at me, and he just stared at me, and I thought, wait a minute, what did I say the last line wrong? What happened on my timing? Because Randall should be laughing, and he's not. And he said, gee, Diane, I find that really sad. All those years ago, somebody said something to you, and you've let that hurt you all these years until you make a joke about it, but it's because it's a painful memory. And he said, I think that's really sad. He said, Diane, he knows me well. He says, I know you've had some experiences that are kind of unusual, and you should be sharing that with people. And now because somebody said something, you don't even think about wanting to do that. And he said, I think you should be talking at, you know, out on the cruise ships to your groups. And you should be talking at your new lecture hall, Learn Our Religion. And you should be talking at BYU Education Week. Well, by then it's like I'm almost on the floor laughing because it's like, right. See, this guy wrote, I gave out the evaluation sheet, and everybody was told, do not sign your name. This is just for us to help us. Did you like the tours? Did our office treat you right? Do you, you know, like the ship? Or will you go with us again? Blah, blah, blah. And don't sign it, but just tell us. And he wrote, I will never travel with you again. I did not pay to hear you speak. I mean, it's like, and then his name was in huge letters. And so, I mean, it's like yesterday. And so when he said, you should be speaking at these, all I can think of, I will never go with you, I didn't pay to hear you speak, you know, and that's underneath my iceberg. So when he said, I think you should do all this, I'm going, yeah, right, Randall. And the more I thought about it, I thought, well, on the ships, I can set up a time to speak, and I've been doing it now for a year. because you can come or not come, but thank you for coming. Or I could speak at our lecture hall, and we charge a small fee, and I can make mine free. So, hey, I could do that. BYU, ooh, that's a lot of stuff, and I'm awfully old to be, you know, maybe turned down and be embarrassed. So that one was a real hard one for him to even say to me. I felt like with a straight face. Anyway, I'll tell you what happened after that later. So I decided, well, maybe I will try to do that, because I do have some things that I've learned through my journey in life. So Randall is a life coach, and he said, I would like to be your life coach. I'm in Texas. You call me every week. I'll give you an assignment. You do it. And my mother raised no fools, so I thought, all right, you're on. So I said, okay, Randall, I'll work with you. Let's see if we can get some of that stuff down there out of my system, because it's never fun to feel certain things, and yet, you know, people don't know you have them in there, but you sure do. So, first assignment, list 50 talents and strengths. I thought, 50? Gee, that's a lot of, that's a big list. And he says, I made it easy for you, Diane. I put 6 down right off. You can do this, 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 and this. Well, I might have come up with those, but then I was stuck. You know, like, I can catch grapes in my mouth, I was a synchronized swimmer, I can twirl a baton, but you know, 50 is a lot of stuff for talents. So I really had to dig deep, and it was hard. And you would think, maybe you would think it'd be easy. I think it was really hard. It was hard to sort of let yourself say, hey, I do that, and that is kind of a talent or a skill. And I went through it, and then I got competitive, and then I said, okay, he wants 50, I'm going to give him 100. And I gave it to him, I was so proud, my ego was good, I felt good, you know. He was very proud of me, and I said, that was really hard, Randall. I suggest you do it sometime. You don't show it to anybody, but just for your own sake. What do you have going for you? What are your strengths and talents? Anyway, I gave it to him, he was very proud of me. I said, but don't ever give me the other one, the 50, you know, faults, because I had so much trouble with the good ones that the other would do me in. And he just listened, you know, and he said, Diane, I'm so proud of you. That's such a good list. You know, okay, your assignment for next week. And I said, whoa, did you not hear me? Because he's really cute. He's got this Texas accent. He goes, Diane, you're just so sharp. I'm so proud of you. And then he gives me this. All of a sudden, that accent didn't sound that good. You know, and I felt like I could see a whip, you know. So all of a sudden, we're not as close as we were, because I said, 50 weaknesses, I just got through telling you, don't make me ever do that one. Well, that one is even harder. That is miserable. And you dig deep, and unfortunately, that list keeps going real fast, you know. And then I thought, I'm going to turn this in, and he's going to say, I had no idea, Diane. All bets are off. I can't work with you. You are a mess, you know. But he didn't. He was very loving. He still has a cute accent. And now I do know he has a whip. So, you know, he's not quite as charming as he used to be. But, you know, that is another thing that I say. Sometime in your quiet moment, make a list of your weaknesses. And I said, I can't believe you still work with me. And he said, Diane, if you went to the doctor and you said, I have this wrong with me, would the doctor get mad? Or would the doctor say, I want to help you? He says, I want to help you be the best you can be. But first, you got to kind of come to terms with what are your areas that are really kind of hard, that are weak, that you want different, but you just hope that nobody hardly can tell that about you. So anyway, he's funny. He sent me this last year at Christmas time, and I said I should put cruises. He says most people worry about what they're going to be eating between Christmas time with all the goodies and stuff. He said they really ought to be worried about what they're eating between the 31st of December and the 24th of the next year. Anyway, he's wonderful. He one of my goals was to lose a lot of weight, and I've lost some of it. And I started writing a book called My 1 Year Transformation. Except now it's like, that's taking me at least 2 years. Because, you know, sometimes we make goals and we get sidetracked and it's hard. But like John, by the way, said the other day, the important thing is that we remember the direction we're going. So anyway, I'm going to, I've come up with like basically four things that I think make you feel better about yourself, give you more peace of mind, make you happier and more joyous with your life. So number one is service. Service. Ah, when Randall told me that, I said, how does service make you feel, you know, better about yourself? And he said, you know, service is kind of a funny thing. He said, service is something that usually you don't feel that great about, maybe in the beginning. He says, and I'm kind of looking like, what? I don't get that. Because, you know, you should feel, oh boy, let's do something wonderful. He said, if the Lord called you up and said, let's all go out and weed the cemetery, how many of you are really going to say, oh boy, I can't wait. I've always wanted to weed the cemetery. That's just going to be great. He says, usually you don't do that. But you do it because it's the right thing to do. You were asked, it needs it, and so you're going to do it. He said, the warm feeling comes later when you do things that are right. And it just gave me a different perspective on service, that it's not, it doesn't matter that you didn't go, oh boy, but that you do it because it's the right thing and the warm feeling will come later. Well, David O. McKay said, man's greatest happiness comes from losing himself for the good of others. A couple years ago, I bought a building, and I moved our company, so all of a sudden to go to work, I had to go a different way. And as I would drive to work, I would pass this house with this beautiful yard. I mean, you could tell, it wasn't Bouchard Gardens. However, you could tell she really put, she put a ton of time into that garden, her yard. It was just fabulous. And as the months would go by, she would change things and decorations for the different occasions and seasons. And I would stop and I would call Larry and say, well, I'm almost home. I'm at the beautiful house with a great yard. You know, I mean, he knew exactly always where I was because I would stop there and there it was. And I used to tell myself, sometime I got to go in and tell her, her yard is so pretty. But, you know, we all have those thoughts. Yeah, you know, sometime we'll do that. So one day I decided, today's the day. I'm going to do it. I pulled up to her car, to her house, in my car, rang the doorbell, and all these dogs come. And then she comes, and she's sweaty because she's been working in her yard. You know, and I said, I'm not selling anything. I just wanted to tell you that I drive by your house every day, both ways, and I comment about I'm at the house with a beautiful yard, and it's so beautiful, and I can appreciate how much work you put into this. And I'm sure a lot of people think this, but I decided to tell you that your house and your yard, the love you put in and the time you put in it, it brightens my day, and I just wanted you to know that. Well, all of a sudden, sweat kind of went to glisten, and she stood a little taller, and she looked a little less stressed, and there was a sweet countenance about her, and I thought, you know, it really made her feel good. But my warm feeling took over as I went to my car thinking, I did something nice for her, but boy, do I feel good. Gee, this is kind of nice, this warm feeling comes later thing. Anyway, there are opportunities around us all the time. President Monson, you are surrounded by opportunities for service. Often small acts are all that's required to lift and bless another. Well, I still think that every time I pass her yard. I normally would tell a story about Brad Wilcox, but John told it, and it was just really his story. So I'm just going to remind you, remember, he didn't fit in, but he did a lot of nice things for people. And then in the end, when he graduated, he got the award for most loved. I love that story. I love Brad Wilcox. He is one of the warmest, most loving people I know. And it's because he's always just kind of looking at ways to just kind of help people and be nice and hug them and brighten their day. And I just feel honored to even know this amazing person. So it's in here, but I'm going to skip that because we've already gone kind of through that story. Bloom where you were planted. Oh, about 20 years ago, I found myself divorced, living in Washington. I had two sons. Life was not really a happy time. And they called me. I just moved there to Olympia. And they called me to the state single adult rep, which is such a wonderful calling. I said, I don't even know anybody. And you know, when you go in there, and you know what? We can all go, I don't want to be in there, but you know, we're all a heartbeat away from that program. Sometimes you're in it because you're never married. Sometimes now you're a widow or a widower, or you're divorced. But it's a program that many of us, probably almost all of us, at some time of our life, will be in it. And it's a program of people who have very hurting souls because of things that have happened. And I found myself being called to come and take over that for that up there in Olympia. And I went to my first thing, you know, a dance, because let's start it off with a dance. Because if you didn't feel rejection when you were younger, let's be a lot older and now go to a dance and see how you feel when you're rejected. So I don't know why they think dances are really a great thing to do, but I saw a lot of people really sad at the dances. I was one of them. But I got asked to dance by this guy, Boyd, and every woman loved Boyd. Because in the course of the evening, he would make sure he danced with every woman in that room. And so for 3 minutes, every woman got to feel special and not like a loser and noticed and feel good about themselves. Well, Lord, Boyd said, Diane, if you really want to understand that program, you have to recognize you're not in it because what can it do for me? You're in it to help people reach out to others. And if you do, you will love this program if that's how you treat it. So I'm going to challenge you, Diane. Every week you come to the dance, you find yourself three people that you don't know, and you make sure you go up to them and you introduce yourself and you find out their name and kind of what their story is. And then the next week when you have three more, you're still checking on those three. Hey, how did that job interview go? Hey, did you get to see your granddaughter? Da 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 da. And you build on it every week. Three new ones. It's not easy, but I took on the challenge. I'm very competitive. I took on the challenge and I got to where I couldn't wait to the dance because I knew I had so many people I wanted to find out what happened and I loved them. And it wasn't about, hey, me, no, I'm a loser. Isn't anybody going to ask me to dance? But what's happening with all these people? Eventually, I had a new woman come into our ward saying, oh, I can't come to that. I don't feel good about that. I don't feel good about myself. And she said, it's different for you. You know everybody. I said, wait a minute. I didn't know anybody when I started. In fact, I only got to know them because I got challenged into it. So it's a way of thinking that when we put ourselves out for others, you kind of do lose yourself in it. And so we had this huge conference called Bloom Where You Are Planted. And I've lived a lot of my life, later in life, with that theory that we are in chapters of our lives at times that it's pretty hard to bloom. But that's where you are, and you have a choice. You bloom, you find a way to bloom with it, or you can be bitter and angry. I mean, that's another option. You know, that's a choice. But as long as you're in a situation, find the way to make it the best. Okay, and behold, I tell you these things, that you may learn wisdom, that you may learn that when you are in the service of your fellow beings, you are only in the service of your God. Okay, so that's service. So now number two. Forgiveness, oh, big word. Forgiveness, we're required to forgive everyone. I know that sounds big, you know, like, I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive, but of you it's required to forgive all men. All men? Men that cheat on you in a marriage? What about men who embezzle from you in a company? What about men who kill your son? See, I'm telling you my life. I have a son that was murdered at age 21. A lot of people meet me and say, boy, you're living life. You go around the world, you go on cruises, you hang out with these wonderful people. These wonderful people have made it where I could live through the darkest part of my life, which is having a son whose life was brutally taken. And it took several years for them to solve the case. In the meantime, when they were trying to solve it, because of a mistake from a dentist with the dental records, my son was declared a missing person. That went on for almost a year. That is the darkest of the whole. because you don't ever know if you're ever going to know whatever happened to your child. Well, eventually DNA came around and became more common to where they finally were able to do it and found out that it was indeed my son's body that was found in a vehicle in California, burned up and had been shot. And so all those years, when I waited for them to solve it, it was during the beginning of this company, but I would go on these cruises with these speakers and they would talk about loving one another and we must forgive everyone. And I had a lot of trips with John Lund and he would talk about forgiveness. And I said, yeah, John, I get forgiveness except for my son. You know, surely the Lord understands I can't. I mean, wouldn't that be almost like saying, it's okay, I forgive you, it's okay. I can't do that. And he said, that's not what it says. Forgiveness isn't saying it's okay what you did. It's saying it's not my place to be the one that forgives you or not. I'm supposed to forgive you. You still have to make restitution with the Lord for our decisions, but you don't hold on to it. And what I have found, and it's now been 15 years, and a priesthood blessing, dear friends, a lot of years, raising another son that I had to be functional with, to say, I can now say, I am close to where probably visiting a prison where two men are in jail forever, one forever and one for a few more years, that I will go and do what I have to do, which is to forgive them. I had to turn it over to the Lord. It would eat me up. And I can say that forgiveness is a blessing you give yourself, because to hold on to it just hurt my life so much. He took so much by taking my son, they did. Do I want to give him the rest of my life? I had another son. Didn't he deserve to have a mother who could could focus on him? It's not been easy. It's been a hard journey. And I've asked it over and over, but surely the Lord doesn't expect me to do that, you know. But that's where I'm at. I'm at where I move on. The Lord will. The Lord does not forgive. He will be the one to decide what is fair and right. But it's not me. And I'm not given that choice to be the one to decide to forgive or not. It'll be an interesting experience. It'll be one last part of that chapter about my son's life. But I share it with you not to say, look at me, I have this happen. Because in my groups for all these years, I've had other people that tell me their stories and I think, oh, how could you live through that? Horrible things. And we all have had things in our life or will that will test us totally. And yet, what we choose to do with those feelings can affect how we live and feel about the rest of our life. You know, when you hold on to hate and bitterness, it's like drinking poison and hoping you get sick. It's destroying you. And they may have gone on and had a happy little life, you know. So we have to come to terms with it. If you want to get rid of some of that stuff that's underneath, and it's bitterness and hate, or disappointment, anger, those things eat away at you, and to continue to let them do that is drinking the poison, hoping someone else is going to get sick. I want to read you something that I treasure when I found it this last year. It's actually something that was found in Mother Teresa's belongings. They thought she wrote it, but she didn't. But it was something she treasured. People are often unreasonable, illogical, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish or ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you are successful, you'll win some false friends and some true enemies. Be successful anyway. If you are honest and frank, people may cheat you. Be honest and frank anyway. What you spend years building, someone can destroy overnight. So build anyway. If you feel serenity and happiness, others may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today, people will forget tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best you have, and it may never be enough, but give your best anyway. This is the part that called out to me. For you see, in the final analysis, it's between you and God. It was never between you and them anyway. So, I can't say enough about the importance of forgiveness, how it can truly make your life better if you find your way to do it, and how it can destroy you if you don't. And you are required, commanded to, and that includes yourself. We make mistakes, and sometimes we beat ourselves up too, and we are just as much required to forgive ourselves. The essence of the miracle of forgiveness is that it brings peace to the previously anxious, restless, frustrated, perhaps tormented soul. And I was a tormented soul, not knowing what was ever going to, if I would ever know what happened to my son. And then to find out and go to murder trials over the years and hear every detail of what happened, and it's in there. And having to find a way to say, I choose not to let that determine the full direction of the rest of my life. So you give it up. This is how I felt. This is from Disneyland. I took this picture from Disneyland. But that is how you feel when you give up horrible feelings toward others or toward yourself. Ah, you feel freedom. So, number three, loving. Ah, loving. That sounds so easy. Love everybody. Just love them all. And sometimes people do things to you. You know, hard to love them. Sometimes it's hard to love people who look different, act different, they're from different countries. They, you know, everybody. It's, they're rude, you know. But you gotta learn to love people. And you were never told, love them if they treat you right. Love, just love them. It's a whole lot easier if you just start letting yourself love them. I wanna tell you about a story. It starts 40 years ago when I was first married, the first time. And I was married to someone who loved boxers. Muhammad Ali, George Foreman, especially Muhammad Ali. This was back in the days I was a young wife, and I did not like Muhammad Ali. I mean that I'm the greatest, fly like a butterfly, sting like a bee, I'm so great. Oh, I did not like him. He loved him. And if I ever would like to have had an argument, let's talk Muhammad Ali, you know? Anyway, he loved Muhammad Ali. Well, he worked for the airlines, and he had a chance to go down to the fight, the Rumble in the Jungle, back in 1974. I know you think I was just a little kid then, but no, I was married, and he was going to go to Africa for the Rumble in the Jungle. Well, at the last minute, he couldn't go. I don't remember why, but his friend that also worked for the airlines, he said, bring me back something. Well, they made three of these posters. They're life-size. I mean, they're like 6 feet tall, and on the building. And the guy ripped it down, rolled it up, and gave it to my husband, who just treasured it, this wonderful poster of these two guys, Rumble in the Jungle. Well, to go a little fast forward on the story, eventually my husband died, and I had the poster. And now it's 25 years ago when I had the poster. And it was at the time when George Foreman was back at being heavyweight champion again. I had a different business. I had an RV dealership. And everybody in there, when I took the poster, said, you should try and get George Foreman to sign it. And I said, oh, hey, that's a thought. I had my son was 11. And I thought, he loved those boxers. That'd be kind of an interesting thing to go after it. But I said, if I'm going to get George Foreman, I should get Muhammad Ali. And they all went, yeah, right, sure. You can get Muhammad Ali? Well, sounded like a challenge. So I said, you don't think I can get Muhammad Ali's signature? If I can get one, I'm going to get them both. So I started this trek to work out a way to meet both of them and have them sign the poster. See, it's signed here because this is later in the story, but the original poster obviously did not have their signatures. So anyway, a few phone calls, a lot of creativity, and the story of my son had lost his father who loved the boxers. Is there a way we could ever get together and you could sign this? And so first we met George Foreman and he signed it. Boy, is he big. You know, he signed it. His signature is like calligraphy, and he's amazing. Very friendly. A couple weeks later, it was Muhammad Ali, and he was starting to get, he was already had been diagnosed with a Parkinson, and he looked a little glazed, and as he signed it, it looked like it took every bit of effort for him to sign it, and he signed several things for me. I think I have 13 things from Foreman, but only three or four from Muhammad Ali, because I started feeling like, wow, it's taking so much of his energy. Anyway, it's quite a story of my son with me going to Los Angeles to meet Muhammad Ali. So they did a story on it when he recently passed away. They did a story on a couple of different channels, and this is the one that they did on Channel 4.
Ali's death has saddened millions, including this Sandy woman who met him 24 years ago. Good For Utah's Rick Aaron has the story of their encounter and the rare poster that brought them together.
An original fight poster from the 1974 Rumble in the Jungle, signed by both George Foreman and Muhammad Ali. For the owner, Diane Larsen of Sandy, it's a memory of three men now gone.
My husband loved the boxers, especially Muhammad Ali.
The 4-foot by 6-foot poster was a gift from her husband's friend who attended the fight in Zaire and took it off a wall of the stadium. After Diane's husband died at the age of 43, she decided to get the poster signed by both boxers.
I thought it would make a memory that I could have with my 11-year-old son to kind of help him remember how his father loved these great legends.
On May 9, 1992, Diane and her then 13-year-old son Casey got Foreman to sign it in Las Vegas. 2 weeks later, they arranged to meet Ali at his Los Angeles hotel.
And he opens the door and walks right up and gives me a big kiss on my cheek. And I'm going, whoa!
Ali was already suffering from the effects of Parkinson's disease, but Diane describes him as kind, gracious, and mischievous.
And then all of a sudden, playful as he was, he started banging away at George Foreman's face on the poster. And of course, I'm going, please don't tear it.
It was time for the signature moment, and afterward, Ali began playfully sparring with Casey.
So he hit Muhammad Ali, and then Muhammad Ali hit him, and then my son hit Muhammad Ali, and all of a sudden, Muhammad Ali went backwards and fell on the floor. And we all went, Then all of a sudden, Muhammad Ali got up, and he got himself up, and we're all just kind of watching him, and he came up to my son, and he pointed in his face, and he said, "Now, you tell your friends you knocked down Muhammad Ali." And you know what? At that moment, he was the greatest.
Sadly, Casey passed away in 2000 at the age of 21, but the memory of him and Ali lives on for Diane.
No audience, nothing to gain from it, but just a few minutes of just being himself to give a boy a memory that he and I would never forget.
So how much is this poster worth? Well, Diane doesn't know because she's never had it appraised. She does say, however, it is priceless to her. In West Jordan, Rick Aaron, Good For Utah.
What a great story. Muhammad Ali, by the way, won that fight with an 8th-round knockout. Many consider it one of the greatest sporting events of all time.
Lots more to that story, but very tender memory to me. You know, it's kind of funny. Now I have that poster locked up in a room where no one sees it, and I think, well, I don't know what I'm going to do with it now because I feel a little bit afraid to have it just out there. But anyway, a wonderful chapter. But remember, I didn't even like him. I did not like him. Why? I did, because he would talk so boisterously and stuff. I didn't know him. But I got a chance to see a glimpse of him. And when he died, I cried because I loved him. And I loved him because I saw who he really was instead of what was just out there. And I think so many times we see things in other people and we don't like them. And we're supposed to love them and we don't half the time know what their story is, what their life's about. And so we don't say, we're not told, love everyone, you know, unless just love everyone. It's a whole lot easier, even though it's sometimes very hard. Now, I wanted to tell you the story. I found my wife very hard periodically. I mean, I've been married and divorced more than once. So here I am, single with these two boys, not very happy. My mother says, you know, you're not very happy. You don't ever laugh, you don't ever joke. I said, well, what do you expect? Look at my wife. And she goes, I rest my case. And I realized that I'd become a person that was just pretty discouraged, disappointed, sad, all those kind of things. And so I went to my patriarchal blessing, and there's a part in there that says, be an instrument in bringing joy and happiness into the lives of others, and they will find joy and happiness in your association. I remember thinking all my life that that meant be the life of the party, but I wasn't having much of a party then in my life, at that point in my life, and I thought maybe it means something more, a deeper meaning than just be big jokester here. So I was on a cruise with some people, and we were in Sweden, and we went to this museum, and it's called the Vasa. This ship is a warship built back in 1624, and it was meant to be the most magnificent warship ever. So the king just kept saying, build it higher, put up more guns, this, more. He just wanted the thrill of having the world think he built the greatest ship. So the town gathers around in Sweden, in this little village, to watch the maiden voyage of the Vasa. I think it went 1,400 yards before it tipped over and sunk and went down for 333 years. 15 people died, were still down there. I mean, it took 333 years for them to finally find it, bring it up, restore it, build a museum around it. They're in the gift shop, is this sign, it's got a picture of it. And it just spoke to me. It had the picture of it, said from wreck to state of the art. And I thought, boy, that's me, wreck. I'm a wreck. I felt like my life was a wreck. And I thought, but look at that, was down there for 333 years, and look at how magnificent it is. And it was so inspiring, and I thought, if it could go from wreck to state of the art, maybe with the right things, the right attitude, hard work, good people, understanding what I'm really supposed to do, maybe I can shoot the direction of state of the art with my life. I can make it better. I can choose. So that is me with a ship. What would that? But it has always been an inspiring picture to me, from wreck to state of the art. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Now, alas, I want to tell you that I came across another thing I'd like to read to you, and it's called The Dash. And our life is just whatever we make it. You know, when you go to a cemetery and you see from this date dash to that date, you know, that's all you see. You don't know anything about their life. And this is a beautiful poem. And I've always had, when I've been telling the story, I have to tell you, I've always had the actual year, so you knew exactly how old I was. Oh, you know, I'm an April Fool's baby, so I started off with issues. But now I took that out. I had Larry, who's so good on a computer, I said, will you get rid of those last two letters? I don't really think I need to tell everybody how old I am, because this is about the dash. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates of her tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of her birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that she spent alive on earth. And now only those who loved her know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard, and are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to reconsider, to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand the way other people feel, and be less quick to anger and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they said about how you spend your dash? Well, it's a choice. It's a choice because we're going to have things that are always challenging us, but the real choice is what do you do with it? So the fourth thing is, remember, service, forgiveness, loving, and last, magnify your talents. You know, everybody has talents. We all have talents. Sometimes I look at people and I think, boy, you, how do you sleep at night? You stole a lot of talents. But we all have them, and we're expected to do something with them. And when we try things, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but if you don't even try, you don't even have a shot at it. I want to say that there are talents, that there are things that I would like to do. I'd like to learn how to play the harp. That'll probably never happen, but you know, I don't know. I play the piano. Maybe I could play the harp. I like to paint. I'm writing a book. Remember my one-year transformation that's taking me 2 years? But here is a quote from Elaine Dalton. Your gifts and talents and your preparation now will help you accomplish your divine mission. And each of us has one. So today I say to you, dear great things, it's not easy to try new things because what comes with it is the possibility of, ugh, it didn't happen, it didn't work. But the other possibility is that it did, and your life can be even better. Now, this is a picture. Isn't this a beautiful picture? Randall Wright, remember the guy that speaks at Ed Week? He told, that is his son-in-law, who, he's not an artist, but he decided to take an art class. Hey, I think we're going to take an art class. This is the only thing he's ever painted. He hasn't even finished it. It's not quite finished at the bottom. He called him up at Ed Week that week, last year, and he said, I'm talking to you with about 350 people here. He says, are you calling to talk to me about that, the painting? And he said, yes. Are you done with it? No. How long would that take? Oh, 10 or 15 minutes. Well, when are you going to do it? I mean, you know, he has a talent, and he's not even using it. And you all have talents. And at times we say, oh, I should do that sometime. I should try this sometime. And you don't. But if you do, you can discover so much excitement later in life. You know, retirement does not mean now let's sit in a chair and just kind of go, I wonder how the weather is today. I mean, you know, you can accomplish great things later in life if we try and reach out and do new things. One of the greatest possible sins would be to return to God the life which he has given us with abilities undiscovered and our talents undeveloped and unutilized. One of Jesus' most bitter rebukes was given to him who buried his talents in the ground. I gave this talk a year ago, and Jack Marshall, who's one of our speakers, came up to me a few months ago and said, just want you to know, by the way, when you gave a challenge to go do something with your talents, I decided to start writing this one book I've been thinking about writing, and I'm working on it. And it was because you said that, and I go, wow, you better put a dedication in there to me, Jack. And it's just kind of interesting how we have different interests, but we sometimes say, oh, yeah, someday. Oh, this is a little thing I want to play for you. These are five young men in Britain who got together and decided to sing, and they sang and performed for British You've Got Talent. And they're all, you know, like laymen, labor guys, and they're, you know, they just have gotten together. I want you to watch the expression on the judges' faces, their eyebrows. Watch the boys, you know, when they explain who they are, how long they've been singing together and what happened. These are just boys who thought, hey, let's go sing. Let's try something.
Hi there, we are Calabro.
Do you have day jobs?
I'm a labourer.
I'm a sales assistant on a petrol garage.
I'm a kitchen salesman.
I work in a Japanese restaurant.
I work in a hospital.
Okay, lovely. How long have you guys been a group?
We've been together for about a month now.
A month? Oh, not long. What makes you think after a month that you're good enough to win Britain's Got Talent?
Natural chemistry, I think.
Okay, lovely. Well, whenever you're ready.
There, out in the darkness, a fugitive running, fallen from God.
Didn't expect this.
Fallen from grace, God be my witness, I never shall yield, till we come face to face, till we come face to face. He lost his way in the dark, mine is the way of the Lord. Those who follow the path of the righteous shall have their reward. And if they fall as Lucifer fell, aflame the sword. Scars in your multitude, scarce to be counted, filling the darkness with order and light. You are the sentinels, silent and sure, keeping watch in the night, keeping watch in the night. You know your place in the sky, you hold your course and your aim, and each of your seasons returns and returns, and it's always the same. And if you fall as Lucifer fell, you fall in flames. And so it must be, for so it is written, on the doorway to paradise, those who falter and those who fall must pay. I may see him
safe behind bars. I will never rest till then. This I swear I
They won. Just thought I'd tell you, they won. And they went for it, and they won. And I just think it's a wonderful story. And they don't look like they would be singing, let alone singing that kind of song. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. Stephen Covey had a wonderful quote that is one of the most inspiring ones, I think. He has, "Living life in crescendo to me means that my most important work is always ahead of me, never behind me. Be an example of someone who is constantly making a difference in the world. There is so much more to do, to learn, and to contribute." So, what have I done in the last 25 years? Well, I started Cruising, it's been 20 years. Just recently, that Learn Our Religion program, BYU, got rejected. They didn't want to hear me. And I thought, that's embarrassing. But you know what? First of all, I think it makes my story more interesting because, you know, I try things. I can still be rejected later in life. Did it disappoint me? Yes. Is it kind of embarrassing? Yes. Is it devastating? No. My life goes on. And maybe next time I'll try it again, a little thinner, a little more polished. I don't know. And maybe they'll say yes, or maybe they won't. But if I don't try, they never will. And so, you know, I still go after dreams. So lots of things have happened very neat. I got my college degree from BYU at age 62. I had four 4 hours left, and I always knew my mother, I'd always promised her I'd do it. I thought this would be a surprise. I'll kind of do it. Had to take a statistics class. I call it statistics. It was awful. Halfway through it, I asked the professor. It was just me and the professor. I asked him, have I learned enough yet to get a B? And he said, or a D. And he said, no. But anyway, so I continued on with it, got an A minus. It was horribly hard. And then the other one was on, you know, personal relationships. I found out how Larry could be a better husband, how we could be, you know, better on all kinds of stuff. But you know what? And we had this graduation ceremony, and my mother's sort of crying, you know, and here she, all these people come, and she thinks it's a birthday party for my husband, and it's really a little ceremony. Susan Easton Black wears the gown, and she has me stand up as valedictorian. It was at our house. So I stood up, I was the only one, stood up as, you know, I don't know, it was a funny day, it was a funny day. And after all the people left, I go to my mother and I say, so Mom, were you surprised? And she said, yes, I really was surprised. I really thought you got your degree about 40 years ago at University of Hawaii. And so I've been carrying around that load of guilt all those years, and she already thought I'd graduated. But you know what? I did something that I feel proud of, even though it was really hard. And so on the last few years of my life, when a lot of people say, now it's time to slow down and be in the rocker chair, got my degree, learned how to deal with some hurts and some angers, learned how to use Siri, learned how to do a pressure cooker once or twice, there's my degree, age 62. Ooh, you'll do the math. Became a grandmother finally at the age of 64. And they just had another one 6 weeks ago. So now that one has nothing to do with me. I bring that up. Why do I bring that up? Well, because I'm a grandmother. Of course, I'm going to show pictures. But the real reason I bring it up is to say sometimes good things happen. You didn't even do anything. But you got good things happening, and you should just be real happy and recognize how joyous life can be. And he's so cute. And we share them with Val and Alan, that one. This building, wreck, the building I bought, remember where I moved the office? Behind it had this really ugly garage. If ever you see a wreck, that's it. I didn't want that. So we ripped it down and we built that. And that's our lecture hall right behind our office. So it's state of the art. So that's my bossa, from wreck to state of the art. Major speakers there. If you ever come into town and you want to hear that, they're great. And we are working on a way that in a few months it'll go global, where you can sign up for a membership and hear these different speakers from all over on all kinds of subjects. Well, that's in the back of my house. It's in my house. Remember yesterday. Hey, how can we remember yesterday? It's what makes us who we are. We can dream about tomorrow. You can do things. It's all part of what's in the future. But right now, you're living for right now, and you need to live with it with pure joy. Finding ways to be happy, finding people to love, everyone around you. Do those nice little things to think of, but actually do them. Be kinder, be nicer, make it your best day so far. And find a way to just say that as I get older, yeah, maybe some things hurt a little bit and my health is not as good, but in my heart and in my mind, it's gonna be my best day so far. And it can be, because it's your choice. It's really your choice. It's not easy, but it's worth it. It's really worth it. Thank you for coming. I hope there was something of benefit to some of you, and know that we've loved being with you. We love what we get to do. We pay a big price, we're gone a lot. So when we're home, we love home. In between, you can have that one, the packing and the flying. But when we're with our groups, or when we're home, we love it. But that's because we're surrounded by people we love. We learned how to forgive, and we're trying to do something that we think we're supposed to do to help people's lives. We hope it's helped you. Thank you for coming with us. We've loved being with you. We hope we can be with you again. And I offer this to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.